speakers who have accepted to talk in this webinar. We're very grateful to you for this availability. The webinar is organized. This is a part of a series of webinars organized by the project NEXUS, which is an international platform for cooperation between EU and US. And the purpose is to discuss cooperation opportunities between EU and US and future priorities around topics to the next generation internet. Now, this particular webinar is about emerging AI technology and its social and ethical implications. We want to put an emphasis here on the social and the ethical implications of AI. As a small introduction, I would say that AI and AI systems, practically seen as automated decision systems, raise countless socio-political questions. Besides the obvious one, which is privacy and security, we have specific social and ethical issues that can be affected by AI. And those include responsibility and predictability of algorithms, avoidance of discrimination that might be introduced by AI, social exclusion, stigmatization, winner takes all market dynamics, which is a very serious social problem, de-skilling, de-socialization, unemployment, just to mention a few. These have been realized, and there are many initiatives within science, business, and government that try to look at AI from a social and ethical perspective. I should say that Europe is pioneering such initiatives. There is the European AI strategy on the famous these days human-centric AI, which in a summary, on the one hand, AI in this in the European context, AI should respect fundamental rights, applicable regulations and core principles and values, above all ensuring an ethical purpose. And on the other hand, the technology used for implementing AI systems must be robust and trustworthy. However, the semantics behind AI are not shared between all the countries that share the common scope and the common target to develop AI. And in particular, they're not shared between EU and US. So that's the reason and the motivation for NEXUS organizing such series of webinars focusing on AI. Now, I'm honored to have with us four distinguished speakers: Erik Mannens, Michael Bletsas from Erik Mannens from imec and Ghent University, Michael Bletsas from MIT Lab, Media Lab, George Giannakopoulos from Democritus, and Jan de Bruyne from University of Ghent. We have four specific topics to discuss. Each one of the speakers will discuss its own topic. I propose to start with Erik Mannens, who is going to talk on the origin of social in AI. And just briefly, his talk will focus on how to achieve ethical AI through transparency and interactivity as values for social AI by design. Erik is a research valorization director at IMEC and professor at Ghent University. He currently heads the data science team of 50 semantic technologies and artificial intelligence researchers. He received his PhD degree in computer science engineering at the University of Ghent, his master's in computer science at KU Leuven, and his master's degree in electromechanical engineering at KHO Ghent. Before joining Ghent University, he worked as a research manager, software engineer, and since 2008 is paving the open data path in Flanders. Thank you very much, Erik.
Thank you, Tonis. All right. Yes, try to screen. All right. Do you see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Yes. Thank you. Come on, baby. Yes. Okay, let's get started, everybody. Thank you for this nice introduction. I'm going to talk about the social aspect of AI. And in fact, I'm going to dive into two subtopics that have to do with social and AI. So what I have been seeing lately is that we as humans, we already work or live together with all kinds of AI agents. And sometimes we are not aware of that. These social AI agent or these AI agents, well, they have to adhere to some things, but they also need information from us humans to really do their job properly. So the two topics I will dive into, it has to do with how transparent are the systems, or should the systems be, and it's in fact up to us humans to make these AI agents transparent enough so they can really do the right thing. And the second topic will be that we have to think on how we interact with these systems. So first, to be transparent, the elephant in the room, of course, these days is bias. And a little test, not going to wait for the answer because we really have lots to talk about. But of course, if we ask what man is to king, then probably the software agent will answer as woman is to queen. Also, Paris is to France as Tokyo is to Japan. But if we ask an AI system, man is to programmer, then he probably will answer as woman is to homemaker. And of course, the real answer should be also programmer, of course. Now, how come that the computer system answers with homemaker? It all has to do, of course, with the data that is fed to the algorithms. If the AI agent out there has to learn from all the data, and of course, if we people talk about programmers, and 99% of the time we talk about a programmer, we talk about he, then he makes, then the AI system, of course, makes the resemblance to, okay, if we're talking about woman or in a certain way, then okay, 99% of the time, if we're talking about homemakers, we talk about women. So, okay, hence, this probably is the right answer. Of course, this is not true. And it all has to do with bias that, alas, we humans put into our data. And do we really do that on purpose? Well, no, because in fact, our brain works in a very peculiar way. We get really, really too much information, and we have to filter in one way or another. We have to filter that out, and hence that already gives input to some bias. A second thing is yeah, there's already too much information, but also in time, what do we still have to remember and what not? Also there, we have an internal filter that kind of makes us remember some things and other things not. So again, giving extra bias into our own knowledge. Another thing that takes into account or that gives extra bias into our data is because, well, some words have the same or different meanings, and if we do not take the context into into the equation, well, then again, without our knowing, we will have some bias into our data or into our knowledge. And the last one, it's from very, 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 when we were very young as a species. Of course, we had to fight all kinds of fierce animals that are now extinct. But yeah, we had to act fast, otherwise we die. And so either you act fast or you flee or you just stand still. So also there, our brain in that way makes it very easy to put bias into whatever information is out there or whatever knowledge we already have. In fact, and this is not really my expertise, but psychologists found out that in without our knowing, we there's more than 200 different kinds of bias that we put into our data or into our information, just because it's inherent to our brain. This famous man was not far off if he then just said, like, okay, intuition, or what we think is intuition, it's just a machine for jumping to, between brackets, biased conclusions. Now, towards these AI algorithms, to give you some awareness, where does it go wrong? How does it come that we give biased data or biased information to these algorithms? There's really, in fact, four reasons. We all know that the current AI algorithms really, really need lots of data to be trained. And once it's trained well, okay, you have your validation data set to validate it and then to let it work. Now, of course, if you have your data set and you have to split it between a testing set and a validation set, well, this splitting of the data should be uniform and everything should be in it. So if you have an unbalanced data set, then of course, bias is creeping in, hidden assumptions and all kinds of inequality will be in it. And if all these kinds of inequality or hidden assumptions will be in it, well, then of course the algorithm, the only thing it can do, it's making and distilling the wrong initial features and thus also giving the wrong answers to your questions. A second reason why you have biased data, it's because you have noisy data. If you do not clean your data enough and make it right for your algorithm, then again, via this noisy data, wrong data creeps in and probably down the line, you will not be able to distill the right features. And then again, you fall into the scenario, if you do not have the right features, you cannot get the right answers. The third example of what it means is if you do not have enough data, because if you only have a small data set, then there's a high probability that it will be unbalanced to start with. And unbalanced, then we go back to the first point, you end up with hidden assumptions, all kinds of inequality, and thus again, you will your algorithm will distill the wrong features, will not be trained well, and thus give the wrong answers. And a last point in this one of what is it? Well, it could be that you have bad or wrong historic data. Most of the time, I cannot stress this enough also with my students, like metadata is much more important than the data itself, because metadata gives you extra contextual information on your data set. Just ask it to Murphy. Maybe you know the story of Murphy. I think somewhere in the 60s, he was a NASA engineer just hired. He had to pick up another project from his predecessor. And I do not know who was who, if Murphy was an Englishman or his predecessor was an Englishman. Anyway, he got the data, worked with it. An 80 million satellite went up, and then within 5 minutes, they had to let it explode because it was not following the right trajectory. What happened? Murphy was using in his calculations the metric system, and his predecessor used the Anglo system with inches and not meters. So yeah, it was he did not look at the metadata of his historic data, so it ran wrong. So that is another reason of why you bias could creep in your algorithm, because you feed it the bad or the wrong historic data. Now, as important as what is also the why. And there we already see the social impact of how we deal or train our algorithms. Also four reasons why it goes wrong. In fact, the first reason is, well, not the right people feed the inclusive data to the algorithm. Read between the lines. Most of the data science engineers are white, middle-aged men. And of course, we, white, middle-aged men, why should we know for every use case as a data engineer what data the algorithm should be fed with? It is better as an engineer, do what you do or do stay where you're good at, namely try to make the algorithm, but then ask the people that are really working in the domain and really also interdisciplinary, different races, different sexes, ask what data this problem domain should be fed to the algorithm, not just think that you, as your middle-aged white engineer, you know it all. A second one is that it's not about feeding the data, but maybe we're asking the wrong questions to get the right data for the problem at hand. And also there, same problem. You're better off if you ask that to the domain experts who have who know the scope and who know the quality about the data at hand, than just being the white male middle-aged engineer that is coding the AI model. A third problem of why we get it wrong is that, and frankly, okay, everybody has that, we do not like testing. It is like with normal software testing, the Pareto effect holds. So 20% of your time you should be coding and 80% of your time you should be testing and debugging. It's the same with an AI system. The training, it's only 20% of your time, really 80% of your time it's data cleaning, data transformation and testing. And that is the reason why the data you give it, it's often biased, because you just think about, or as an engineer, you think about just what, and you don't think about maybe other social, economical, political things that need to be right to have your data set right. A fourth thing, why it is not working, is that, yeah, different geographical regions have different social values and hence also different truths. Like what is true in India might not be valid in the US or vice versa, which means that, okay, it could be that you have a nice problem domain and you train it with data in the US and it works in the US. Well, you cannot just migrate your trained algorithm to India and hope that it works. No. Okay, you can use or probably reuse the algorithm, but you definitely have to retrain it there with the current geographical data from there to really make your algorithm work. Now, we as researchers, we know that we are only at the beginning of AI to work properly with all these things. But we really on the computer science part, we really need to work further on fair AI, transparent AI, collaborative, safety critical, privacy preserving, trustworthy, explainable, accountable, sustainable, and robust. Okay, these might be 10 buzzwords, but while there's on the left-hand side, we're trying, or there's already quite a bit of research to be done on the left-hand side. So there are already frameworks and algorithms that take care of trying to be as transparent as possible. But on the right-hand side, trustworthy, explainable, accountable, sustainable, and robust, we're just scratching the surface as computer scientists. And yeah, the next couple of years, definitely in Europe, a huge, a trajectory that that needs to be further researched. Of course, we and as a research community, but also the big players already know that we really have to take care of the social impact and the ethical impact of AI and all the big ones. Well, formed already a few years a partnership on ethical AI and how AI should be really sustainable and beneficial for people and society. And I must say, it's my own personal opinion. I like the way how Microsoft, IBM, Google, and there's also DeepMind looks at that. I more have a problem of how Amazon and Facebook takes care of this partnership. And okay, you could say we can definitely blame both Facebook and Amazon, because while their business model is completely different as the one from IBM, Microsoft, and Google, Facebook and Amazon really only thrive on user data, whereas the others can also make their money just off running the services for other businesses. So there, I would say that both Amazon and Facebook, every day I see articles of how they really should not work with AI, and they're really not good pupils in this class, but I hope that it will get that better sooner. Now, the second part I want to talk about socially is that, well, yes, in the next couple of years, it will even be more important that we humans give feedback to these AI agents and vice versa. It will both make the agent better or us better. So there will really be kind of a collaboration between the AI agents and us humans. So we will learn to really live next to each other and make each other better. I already told you, this is how life will be. There's already lots of agents out there that purely run on AI, but we can really do a better job at this one. What we also should know, or definitely what I think, is that we are still better in some stuff, like the top part of this slide of IBM, but we're definitely we're never going to excel in NLP or pattern identification. So that's a lost battle. So, and then for me, that is okay, as long as we know that we can rely on these systems to really do that and help us in all kinds of problems where these kind of systems can help us to become a better society. I can imagine in the future that probably lawyers or not the lawyers themselves, but the courts, that they really also kind of not only use the lawyers, but maybe also an AI machine to help them eliminate some kind of bias in something. So yeah, the interaction will be both way. We will interact with the systems, the systems will interact with us, and we will give each other feedback. Yeah? So we will get better and they will get better. Now, we must understand that for now, that machine intelligence is not the same as human intelligence. All the agents out there, it's narrow AI, and it will at least be another decade or two before we will have something as that there will be some generic AI available. Now, knowing that these machines are only good at very something very specific, that's a major challenge for user experiences and also for the adoption of these kind of agents. So whenever there's an agent out there, we as humans should be able that we should always know that, okay, it's not a human, but an agent that is trying to help us. And we should know, okay, the agent is probably only good at that and certainly not in that. So it will help us not be cross with this machine if something is not happening like it should be. I think now I have a little video. No, it's in two slides. All right. So, and in order to these agents to become very good and help us, therefore, not us as a human, we as humans, but also all the firms out there, we should try to democratize the knowledge out there for these agents so that they can really work well. Because if they work well or not, well, that depends greatly on the amount of accessible knowledge that we give to these machines, of course. And there, it is my firm belief that all the data and all the knowledge should not end up with only the big five, but some way or another, all this knowledge should be able to be at least after a certain amount of time, be able to be valorized by also small SMEs or governmental organizations. So also there's lots to be done. So knowledge can be really democratized for everyone and for all the agents out there. Another cool thing that is happening right now is that, in fact, how we interact with these AI agents will become better through AI. So how we interact with these kinds of machines, these days it's still with a mouse and a keyboard or whatever, but the further we go and via AI, we will, with these AI systems, we will interact more in an intuitive, human-friendly way. We will really interact via voice, via gesture, via immersive and tactile things, and conversational agents will become better and better. Camera agents will become better and better. Artificial reality, virtual reality, or magnet reality agents will become better and better, primarily fueled by AI algorithms. And maybe I think now this movie comes up. Maybe you heard it's already 1 year old, the last attempt of Google of having a conversational agent. Well, if you close your eyes, you cannot see or hear the difference between the AI agent and somebody else on the phone. I will try to...
As I said earlier,
let me see. Okay, from here it starts.
Hi, I'm calling to book a women's haircut for a client. I'm looking for something on May 3rd.
Sure, give me 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
Sure, what time are you looking for around?
At 12 p.m.
We do not have a 12 p.m. available. The closest we have to that is a 1:15.
Do you have anything between 10 a.m. and 12 p.m.?
Depending on what service she would like, what service is she looking for?
Just a woman's haircut for now.
Okay, we have a 10 o'clock.
10 a.m. is fine.
Okay.
Well, you get the drift. This is really real time. So I think it's amazing from Google what they did, and probably GLT3 is behind it. Real time, they can really understand what the other person is asking, and they can also formulate a real answer. Of course, that is really, really very niche. If I'm on the phone with the same system and I ask the same system what's the square root of 4, probably the system will not be able to answer that. So this system is only able to make an appointment at the hairdresser, make an appointment at the restaurant, and that's about it, right? So we have to know that there's a system behind it, and we have to know beforehand as a human, okay, this system is good in this and probably not in something else. And in some cases, the system or the AI system is probably even better than us humans. For example, there's here a camera system that can, via infrared imagery, can detect human emotions. And I, frankly, if I would have a glasses on fueled with a camera and that algorithm, I probably would have less quarrels with my kids or my wife, because no way that I can by talking or looking at my wife or children have these 16 different emotions captured. So in the end, these systems will be able to even see more things that we humans can, but that is okay. They will help us in solving problems. Now, to end, I will show you this one, and then I will tell you what's wrong and what should go better before ending. So attention.
Say Alexa.
Let's play Digger.
I can't find the song to Good Digger.
Let's
play Screech Loud.
Let him do it.
Let's play Digger Digger. Let's play Digger Digger.
Bobby, can you talk to play wheels?
You want to hear a station for porn detected, porno ringtone, hot chick, amateur girl, quite
no,
sexy.
No.
Pussy anal dildo ringtone.
Alexa, stop!
All right. So normally I have time to ask my students what's wrong here. There's two problems. The first problem is the first thing I said, this algorithm was tested by middle-aged white men. This first system of Alexa was trained probably with only male voices, right? So it was not able to really detect the higher pitch of a woman, let alone a child, right? So they should have done a better job here. So here a certain bias crept in. Now the other thing that went wrong is just something engineering. They did not put into account contextual information. So let's say you detect it's a child, then by default, and there's just some simple ruling in engineering, okay, when child, no porn, no blah blah blah, right? So two problems here in this use case, and by now, because also this movie is already 1 or 2 years old, I hope by now if my little child talks to Alexa, we will not have this very funny result.
Okay, sorry to interrupt.
I'm done.
Okay, good, brilliant.
Thank you. So I guess the next, should I de-share or will somebody else share?
First of all, I'd like to thank you. It was incredibly interesting. I understand that political correctness, if I may, takes a new dimension with AI. Stops to be a political or ideological discourse, becomes an engineering issue. Thank you very much. I would like to introduce the next speaker, who is Michail Bletsas, who from MIT Media Lab, who is going to talk about the title. It's not enough to be right. How the scope of the talk is how humans understand a machine learning, not only how to use machine learning, but also how to incorporate it properly into problems context. And I'm looking forward to some successes and failures in deploying AI. Professor Bletsas is a research scientist at the MIT Lab, Media Lab, where he has been working since 1996. His current research interests include network security, wireless networks, building efficient high-performance machine learning computing infrastructures, and the intersection of AI with society. Over the years, he has advised governments around technology policy issues and provided expert opinion in technical matters to top-level officials. Professor Bletsas has been a frequent keynote speaker in international conferences and has been engaged in many civic activities. He holds an undergraduate degree in electrical engineering from Aristotle University of Thessaloniki and MSc degree in computer science from Boston University. Michail, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Andonis, for the introduction. I want to make a note that I'm not a professor, just an engineer. Eric's talk gave me a good segue into mine. First of all, I have to make a note that ever since the first founding conference of AI up in Dartmouth in the late 50s, generalized AI has always been 20 years away. And Eric also confirmed that rule. The interesting thing about AI, probably solving generalized AI, is the ultimate challenge for the human mind. It's very fundamental. And every time we make a step, we make progress, we climb up a little bit, we see that the peak has moved away from us. It's always 20 years away. It's very interesting. My interest in AI was started with discussions with Marvin Minsky. Marvin Minsky was among the founding faculty of the Media Lab. And he spent a lot of time. He just dropped by my office, ignoring whatever I was doing, and he would start talking about things, mostly having to do with computers and people and how they interact. And, in the beginning, I could never tell him to stop, and I would usually drop whatever appointment I had next, but I don't regret it. I learned a lot from him. He would be kind of amused to see the progress today. Unfortunately, he passed away a few years ago because we are nowhere closer to real AI, which in most practitioners' mind means symbolic manipulation. We don't really know how to deal with notions, with higher concepts, but we are very good in processing data. And what is happening today in AI, it's an emergent phenomenon. If you think about it, there hasn't been any real progress made in the past 30 years. The algorithms were known for quite some time, since the 80s, back propagation or something that was invented in 85, I believe. What happened, though, is the convergence of computing. Obviously, we have a lot more capable computing, and most importantly, the availability of high volumes of data. And Erik described very well all the challenges that we have with actually training those AI models today. I would make another argument. I would go further, and I would say that it's not enough to just train the algorithms. You have to train the people on how to use these things, and you have to use the right tool for the right problem. Right now, because of fashion around AI, we are in the stage of enthusiasm where, you know, machine learning has become the new hot sauce for science. Machine learning makes everything tastier in science. Whoever writes proposals for research grants knows that. I mean, most of them have some form of machine learning applied to an existing program problem. And sometimes this application is not proper. Sometimes good old analytical methods could have been better, but this is the state of the world right now. So I'm going to tell a story. I'm going to demonstrate my point by telling a story, and I'm going to move you. We're going to go briefly to a town in Michigan called Flint, close to Detroit. Flint was famous for many years because it was the home of the largest General Motors factory in the world. Back in 2013, the city hit hard by the move of industry out to other places, by the movement of industry out, came into receivership. The state assumed its management, and one of the things that they decided to do was to switch their water supply from the Detroit system to a newer system that was not quite ready to take them. So they had to take the KWA pipeline, water through the KWA pipeline that was under construction at the moment. So temporarily, they decided to switch their water supply to the Flint River that was going by their city. In the process of doing that, they did it in haste, and they forgot somehow to properly treat the water with anti-corrosive agents. Those are necessary because most of the older cities in the US still use lead pipes or galvanized pipes that have a very bad reaction with chlorine agents that people put in the water for sanitation reasons. And make a long story short, shortly after they did the switch, they noticed that the water became discolored. They had brown water coming out. The General Motors factory in the town was the first to notice and stopped using their water because it was corroding the equipment. And in the picture on the left, you see the pipes that were coming out, what happened to their pipes because of the lack of anti-corrosive treatment on the water. Shortly after that, people noticed health effects. You know, I think we all know that lead in the water is very bad, especially for kids and older people. The state and the local governments tried to see what they could do. Eventually, the problem became exposed. We actually gave an award at the Media Lab to some pediatricians who exposed the issues first with child developmental problems. Some people from the University of the city decided that old lead pipes had to be replaced. Lead pipes have been outlawed in the US for the past 30 years. However, in older places, they are still in use. It's very expensive to replace all of them. People are replacing them, municipalities are replacing them, but they are still there, and hence the water has to be treated properly so that lead doesn't come out of these pipes into the water. the city decided to replace them. They didn't have the resources at the point, and they got some help from the University of Michigan, where a team of volunteers put together a machine learning model that could predict which homes had lead pipe connections. They used initial data from the building department, from the water department, looking at paperwork used to connect somebody to the water supply, paperwork going back even 100 years. And they did some initial testing. They use the data from the initial testing, and by testing I mean they dig out the pipes in every home and they saw whether they were lead or more newer copper pipes. In the case that they were lead, they would replace them. They trained their model, and in 2016 they started fully deploying their model after improved by the initial data. They used actually a very precise also means of digging using hydrovising, essentially with a water jet, opening much smaller holes and not having to do too much digging. Long story short, their efforts, their total success rate — by success rate, I mean how many times when they dug, they found pipes, lead pipes that needed to be replaced — was over 70%. So they were able to predict with over 70% accuracy where they should dig. The city was very happy. This was saving a lot of money, or so it seemed at that point. And they decided to move forward with hiring a very big engineering company, national engineering company, to finish this project and replace all the lead pipes in town. They did that. There were some hiccups in between the end of the first team's appointment and the new engineering thing picking up, but in 2017, they suddenly noticed that the success rate that the new team had gone down to less than 15%. So every time they dug, only 15% of the times they would find actually lead pipes. And people started wondering what was happening. Because of the lapse in judgment in time between the two teams, the new engineering firm wasn't familiar with the machine learning model and stopped using it. Actually, in this picture, we see the results of that machine learning model, where the with blue we see the prediction of the model for copper pipes, and with red the prediction of the model for lead pipes. And with the black dots, we see where actually the engineering company was digging, which neighborhood it was digging. And it turns out, and that's the actual data from the city, it turns out that the mayor got involved. And the mayor said to the engineering company, I said, I don't care about this model that much. When one of my constituents sees that their neighbor's home has been, neighbor home's pipes are being dug out and replaced, and then we don't dig at his home, his or her home, I get a lot of complaints. So I ordered the engineering company to go out and dig whole neighborhoods up. Bottom line, this is what they did. With the red squares, you can see zones that they dug the whole neighborhoods up, and you see what they found. Only the red dots were actually lead pipes. So they wasted a lot of money. The federal agencies that had financed the project based on the successes of the machine learning model application actually sued the city make them change the management of the project, because otherwise they would keep digging the whole city up and finish, the funds would finish before actually the lead pipes were replaced. So here we have an application where the machine learning model works very close to perfectly compared to the non-use of the machine learning model. And nevertheless, it was abandoned. And the reason for that is because the people who made the decisions didn't actually sell it properly to the public. So when you have a decision process, it's very hard. And as we said before, since we are very far away from generalized AI, there is no way that we can, there is always has to be some human that's accountable in this process. And without that accountability, with that accountability comes the, you have to also be able to sell that decision process. Besides explaining and telling why you took that decision, you have to be able to sell it. And when it comes to, politics and administration, local or more global, you have to be able to give a very, very good explanation. So the bottom line is that humans have to remain in the loop, but they have to remain in the loop in a very informed manner. And I believe that's the biggest challenge that we are facing right now, because what happens right now is not that much different from applying computers in the early ages of computing. They are extenders of human intelligence. So I like to use more the term extended intelligence as opposed to artificial intelligence. These are tools that we are using, and we have to, now we have the extra difficulty or the extra challenge that, you know, machine learning algorithms being computational statistics at their core are not easy to explain. They are not easily explainable. We still can trust them for certain things if we have good data to feed them, and we have, if we know their application. And in this specific context, this is one of the companies these days that is doing a very good job in actually helping municipalities do preventive maintenance in their water systems, because it's preventive maintenance is not happening under the stress that it happened at Flint. Everybody's working. This is working great. Their business is expanding right now. It's a Boston-based company. It's happened to know them. That's, I thought it was a very good example. But because they don't have the politics involved, they can actually go in and help save a lot of money to municipalities, doing exactly the same job that the original algorithm did at Flint. Thank you very much.
Okay, we thank you, Michael. That was very interesting, and it was a very tangible example of how humans must be in the loop, stay in the loop, and not only humans, individuals, but whole systems, political systems, and institutions. Thank you very much. We are honored. Any pressing questions to Michael before we move on? Okay, there's going to be hopefully a question and answer session at the end, but if there's something pressing, we can take it now. Okay, if not, then we move to the next speaker, who is George Yannakopoulos, talking about misconceptions on AI, technical versus theoretical, unbiased versus biased, global versus local, the title. It's interesting. It's a good link with the previous speakers. It deals with how humanity starts to understand that the relation with AI is an interaction with our own selves. And it brings out the need to co-design, to co-develop, co-evaluate technology, AI technology, because as it is written here, what we shape also shapes us. George is currently a research fellow in NCSR Democritus. He has worked for more than 15 years on domains such as natural language processing, machine learning, data mining, biomedical informatics. He graduated from the Department of Informatics and Telecommunications from National University of Athens in 2005. He was awarded a PhD on artificial intelligence, and he has more than 15 years of industrial experience in information technologies and IT consulting, covering domains such as software engineering, medical informatics, data mining, and machine learning. George, we are honored. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I hope you can hear me. Actually, the honor is all mine. Adonis, and thanks for the introduction. I will share my screen now. Okay, so we are going, for starters, I would like to thank the previous speakers. I always say that an event is very successful when you feel that everyone has been preparing your presentation, more or less. And it's a good thing I did not repeat things that other speakers have said, as if we had agreed on the content. What I want to share is essentially that there are many misconceptions on AI. And my main reason for being here is that I would like us to discuss, understand that AI is not what we have in mind, right? And I think that also the previous speakers somehow contributed to this understanding that there are things we have understood differently. And I do not refer only, only to people not closely aware of what AI is about. I refer also to technical people that follow through the vision of several people who have effective communication skills. Also, as the previous speakers said, AI is a hype. You know, there exists hype in AI. It has been there for, I don't know, one too many years. So we know that AI is a current trend, and it follows a hype cycle, this kind of curve that explodes in the beginning, expectations explode with it, but over time we have somehow to reach a maturity level that will allow us to use AI as we should. Now, my point in my presentation is that AI strongly reflects the humans. And I will say more about that later on. I think we saw, let's say, we caught some glimpses of this, got a glimpse of this in the previous talks, but I'm going to make it more specific now. And we're going to see that AI is not about being technical. And it's not unbiased, and perhaps should not be, but not in the way we talk about it. And I will get back to that. And the last thing is that AI can be very local, and perhaps should be very local. Now, let's see what happens today, right? This is a very, let's say, vague or high-level overview, bird's-eye view of the ways, the main avenues of teaching a machine, somehow summarized in a simplistic way. But I think it's a good start. So one way to teach a machine, to transfer knowledge so that it can work somehow in an intelligent manner, is about explicitly stating the things you want it to know. It's explicit knowledge. And people working on the domains know that this is mostly related to knowledge engineering, knowledge representation, and reasoning processes. So this is one way to state what you want the AI to know about the world. And it may be extended to a number of added, let's say, ways to bring in knowledge, like the semantic web and other explicitly stated knowledge. But it's still, this knowledge is explicit. There's a second way, that is learning by example. We've mostly met this in machine learning. So it's trying to teach a computer to tell apart, I don't know, apples from oranges by showing these to the machine, to the intelligent machine. And the idea is that over time, this machine will be able to classify things. And of course, there is a similar, let's say, learning process in the regression setting where you wanted it to be able to predict values. So it sees historical data, for example, from a, stock market value, and it tries to determine patterns that will identify what will happen next. A prediction, a prophet of sorts. Perhaps short-sighted mostly, but still can be extremely useful. Now there's a third way related to learning through penalty and reward. And this is mostly what we call reinforcement learning. You will see that I kept a very simple view of this presentation. There's actually a video claiming that, as usually, it's prepended with the words Google AI managed to, because people will believe this, you know. It says that Google AI managed to learn to walk on its own. And this video shows a fake human, a representation of a human in a 3D world, a 3D game, imagine. But over time, tried different strategies of walking and managed to learn on its own. But this is a lie, and I will explain why in the next slide. So these are three main avenues of learning, but I claim that behind all of this, you can find the human in a number of ways. Now, let's get more precise here, right? More focused. The first is that when you explicitly declare the knowledge that the machine owns, of course, you are, you know, an extremely, let's say, strict tutor. So whatever you do not say, or whatever is not directly implied by your claims, by the knowledge you have transferred there, is not available as knowledge. And this might mean many things depending on the kind of questions you ask to the machine. But essentially, what you say, what you claim, what you provide as explicit knowledge to the machine is very restricted for the machine. So you define its knowledge. And also the way you will describe this knowledge, the formal representation of these things is a whole domain in itself. You know, we have ontology engineering, the way to model what you are thinking, essentially, a concept or a domain in a very strict manner, efficient manner for the machine. And there is a huge part. So most of human communication is essentially implicit. So we are not used to stating those things, but we need to for a machine. This means that we are very prone to forgetting things that can be critical. And this is also related highly to social skills and so on and so forth. Now, concerning the learning by example, again, we see the human behind this, because what happens is that the machine will learn by the things we showed it. Erik before said that there can be great bias in the data you show it, and also the data you do not show. Again, what you omit can be critical. And even the selection of learning algorithms is a bias implicit of the researcher to the machine. So it's not that all algorithms learn the same thing. So it's very important that we know that the selection of training algorithm provides bias to what can be learned and how. Now, and in the reinforcement learning, it's the same setting. Even though the video I talked about before said this, you know, this fake human, in the 3D world, this mimicry of a human actually learned to move in a funny way on its own. But it was not on its own. We had provided the penalty and reward function. This is the fascism of feedback. You know, when we are small children, if the parent says, don't do that, and he or she slaps our hand, we know that this was a bad thing to do. Or even the sentimental, the sentiment that the parent can transfer to the child act as a reward function. So the function is what defines the system again, and we define the function. And of course, we provide also the algorithms that allow it to learn. We tell it the possible combinations that make sense for it to change. So in all these three settings, the human is ever present, even if sometimes we do not understand it. Now, I want to talk about the theory, the technical aspect of AI. And, you know, people think that this is a common misconception. Science is always exact, and especially natural sciences. This is not correct. We know that it's a constant evolution process. Science needs to be able to surpass itself with a new theory, a new set of data that will define new, let's say, verifiable truths. Within the scope of verifiability we have defined. Now, in AI, the same stands. So we do not, there is no strict, single strict definition of intelligence, which implicitly means that there is no strict, unique definition of artificial intelligence. And you will see that we, the families, usual families of definitions, refer either to human as a point of reference or to logic, which means human logic as a point of reference, even though it would mean the math that the human has created. So there are several challenges here, and there are challenges regarding how do we define the ethics of an intelligence if we cannot define our own. So we start by an introversion process. And there are, of course, other things, like Michail said before in his talk, that when do we accept an AI? It's about acceptability. When would we say, yes, I want this? And I have a very interesting example. I think a group in the Aristotelian University of Thessaloniki have created an excellent application trying to help young parents by identifying patterns in the baby's cry that can say whether the baby feels, you know, pain or it's time to eat and so on and so forth, or wants to sleep or is actually sick. This is an amazing helper, right, for new parents. With one glitch, the parent will stop turning to the baby to identify the problem and will start turning to a machine. What happens is that the interaction between parent and child changes radically. This parent, over time, may not evolve the sentiment and the feeling of the child over time. So when the child is 18 years old, the example I say, you see the mother sees the child pass through the door for 2 seconds and says, something is wrong. I think he's in love or she's in love. This is an amazing pattern recognition capacity, taking into account all the world knowledge and common sense that Erik identified. So it's very, very important, this thing. Now, another thing is that, so the impact of AI on society, on research, on learning, essentially for me, because I do not want to be a prophet, is unknown. It's as if claiming that we knew what the web would bring about. We did not know. Things co-evolve with the web. So we know that our functioning has changed, especially in crisis times as we are, through the use of tools. Once you have a screwdriver, it changes how you react and act. The same happens with AI. Now, moving a little further and more quickly forward. So is AI unbiased? And I think that the previous speakers covered this. No, because we choose the data in learning and the knowledge, as I said, and the algorithms. No, because we are not unbiased. And I will get back to that. No, because learning and generalization can only exist through bias. Imagine if we could not cluster my different views of the face to form the notion of George. This essentially means that I have a bias. If I cover my eyes, perhaps, or if I wear a mask, people would stop recognizing me. The way we learn is based on bias and forming groups of things. And we do it in several different ways. So humans have inherent biases to be able to learn. So it's about removing all bias. It would mean not learning, considering everything different and not grouping things. But we want to remove unwanted bias. And the unwanted bias is defined by the social values of a specific society. So unbiased AI is not real. And perhaps it's not about removing the bias, but what we want to remove is unwanted bias. Now, and we move on to global versus local. So ethics, you know, I think Western civilization with an amazing achievement has come to form, has a different way of facing things as perhaps Eastern civilizations, as we have seen them. So I think in ancient Greece, from the very few things I know, the truth was about common constant search. Now we need very strict definitions to be able to talk about the truth. So we expect that the ethics is a single absolute truth. This is a challenge. And it's a challenge because the result was the interpretation of the truth from the people. So this is a challenge. Doesn't mean truth does not exist. I'm not saying this, but we have to take into account that there are, as I said, implicit and explicit biases per person and, of course, per community. And we also have another problem. Is math enough to express ethics? So the expressiveness of language is a completely different story and the common understanding of it. So there are the presentation challenges. And if we manage some, so is the Turing paradigm enough to be able to calculate everything we want regarding ethics? We do not know. We cannot explain this. So we need to expand our scientific language to be able to account for these things. And the last question here is, do we want global ethics? Do we want to impose a set of rules that it will be globally acceptable and only those? This does not take into account the evolution humankind always has had. So it's restrictive. We have to be able to see it as a dynamic process of convergence in the meaning and the things we co-search. Now, there's another very important point here in global versus local. AI is a result of it. It's not, you know, it doesn't stand on its own. So I remember reading about the conversation between, I think, Elon Musk and I don't remember the name of the Oriental, let's say, aspect of AI. Well, Elon Musk just said, if we mimic the brain, we've mimicked everything. But the Alibaba owner, I think, I don't remember the name, forgive me, said that if we figure out the brain, this is an excellent start to be able to figure out all the other things. So it's whether we consider that the single point of, let's say, interaction with the human is the brain and everything is in there, or whether we perceive the human in a holistic manner, take into account also his or her interactions with the environment. So culture will lead to different types of research and different views of the scientific research. This is very, very interesting. So we are not unbiased even in our roots somehow, right? And of course, we've seen in the history of science, again, for the very few things that I know, that scientists are deeply affected by the culture they live in. Whether trying to show that everything is a result of a global order or of randomness, this is closely related to where you lived and what the society they are represented. So we form expectations, we form acceptance rule of systems, we define different goals, and so we pursue different research directions. And all this means that AI is a societal outcome, an ongoing process, and will be forever like that, as anything else in science, I would state here. And there is one last thing here, global versus local. So about AI and democracy, we know that democracy is not the same around the world. You know, the application of democracy, and we've seen this in numerous exciting ways recently, but anyway, we know that applying AI can change democratic processes. This is very interesting. The information bubble changes. So simply the fact that you enter a social medium which tries to personally offer more, let's say, acceptable types of information means you live in your own, it strengthens your own small world. So you cannot be effective in an open environment. This is very weird. So we know that AI can affect democracy, but it's the other way around as well. Can we discuss about AI, the next steps? Yes, we can. The EU, with all these consultation processes, and also this will happen in Greece, it's an ongoing process, we can contribute as individuals regardless of our technical background. This is very interesting and very important, because if indeed it's a horizontal enabler or changer of things or disruptor of the AI, then all should have a say on where we want it to go as a society. And you will see here that I have a link, the democratizingai.gr URL, where we have in Democratus, it's been a year since we have been working on a Greek national strategy. And there you can find a white paper that was talked about actually democratizing by bringing everyone on board on this process and not as a single decision. And again, moving to a close, there are several decision points you can see listed here. In every single point, the human plays a role, from starting research to building systems, to agreeing to their use, installing them, supporting, evaluating, and revisiting whether we want to accept them or not, and evolving them to something we do want to have. So it's everywhere the human is behind. So what I want you to remember, I would love you to remember, that all of us, is that AI is about discovering the human, understanding and mimicking, supporting the human. Again, I agree with the extended AI or augmented AI people say, but also co-evolving. We do not know where AI will go because we evolve with it. And this is very interesting. This is why we will always have a job, right? We want to know where we will go. And AI has one too many human traits. It's amazingly human. But not only those, there are these scalability issues, so it offers new potential. We need to apply interdisciplinarity to form the AI we will want under the perspectives we will need. And the idea I would like to offer is we need to form a virtuous cycle of evolution to be able to lead AI through this cycle iteratively to the AI we want. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, George. That was very interesting. Very, very interesting. I'd like to pick up something that you said that comes from ancient Greece, ancient Athens, that truth, in fact, does not exist. What exists is the process of finding truth. And this is something that maybe contradicts current Western political correctness values, but I think we should revisit that notions and probably integrate them into AI, because as you said, AI is a process. We can never be unbiased. We can never be absolutely true. Okay, thank you very much. Any pressing questions before we move to the next speaker? Okay, thank you. The next speaker is Jan de Bruyne, talking about the regulation of AI, an overview of the regulatory framework and tort liability. This talk is might be a bit different than the others in the sense that it really intends to touch the legal perspective of AI, the legal dimension. And it will provide an overview of the major regulatory and initiatives on AI in Europe. And Jan will focus on some legal liability challenges that may arise when AI systems cause damage, which is a dimension that is definitely within the social and ethical aspects of AI. Jan obtained his master's degree in political sciences at the University of Ghent, and a master's degree in law at the same university. He has successfully defended his PhD in September 2018 on a topic dealing with the liability of third-party certifiers. He was a Van Kalker Fellow at the Swiss Institute of Comparative Law, has been a visiting fellow at the Institute of European and Comparative Law of Oxford University, and at the Center of European Legal Studies of the University of Cambridge. He started working at CiTiP in October 2019, and he will continue working on his postdoctoral research on robotics, artificial intelligence, and liability at the Ghent University Faculty of Law and Criminology. He has numerous publications in international journals and books on different legal topics, such as certification and liability for damage caused by robots. He is also a regular speaker at conferences and seminars. Welcome, Jan. The floor is yours. We are honored.
Yes. Can you now hear me?
Yes, fine.
Okay. So thank you very much for this kind introduction. Slight correction. I'm no longer working at Ghent University. I'm still associated, but no longer as a postdoc researcher. I'm now working at Leuven at the CiTiP on the legal and ethical aspects of AI, and especially focusing on liability. So thank you for inviting me. It's a real pleasure to hear all these experts. And as mentioned by one of the speakers, I am not a professor yet, hopefully one day. And many topics have been addressed already that I also wanted to raise. Now, what will I discuss about? I will first discuss some implications of AI. It's very brief. It's an overview because many of them have already been touched upon here. I will then focus on some regulatory evolutions at the EU level. I will try to do it very quickly to come to the most interesting part of my presentation, namely the pending issues and challenges from a liability perspective, as well as some food for thought and discussion, and maybe some for the Q&A in the Q&A session. I will try to make it within 10-15 minutes to make sure that we can end on time. Now, here you have a list of several ethical, societal, and legal issues. Many of them have already been addressed. I will not discuss them thoroughly. I think one of them is the role of which the previous presentation excellently showed what it is. Professor Mannens talked about AI bias. So a lot of things have been addressed. What I would focus on is that AI, in addition to these ethical concerns, also has several legal implications, of course. It affects nearly all legal domains because of its specific characteristics, namely autonomy, self-learning abilities, the black box problem. So these essential characteristics actually challenge the regulatory framework. Considering the many challenges for the regulatory framework, it is no real surprise that the EU took several initiatives. It started in 2018 with the AI approach strategy to AI, focusing on the fact that the EU should be a leader when it comes to AI research. Companies should be prepared for the AI technological revolution, and also an ethical and legal framework has to be ensured. More importantly, in 2018, the HLEC group and the high-level expert group on AI was established. It issued several recommendations, for example, the policy and investment recommendations. But more importantly, it also issued the ethic guidelines on artificial intelligence in 2019, which was followed by the ALTAI assessments list, the assessment list for trustworthy artificial intelligence. The aim of these documents is really to promote trustworthy AI, which is trustworthy AI refers to the fact that it's lawful, it complies with the legal framework, it is ethical, and it's robust, technological robustness. Now, the development and use of AI systems, the idea is that it should comply with these seven key requirements, and it's really something, an important framework within the EU, this ethical, trustworthy AI. So I list them there, human agency, accountability, transparency. So the idea is that AI developers, AI systems should comply with all these ethical requirements. One major challenge, and in this regard, it's already a call for somehow discussion and cooperation, is how do you translate these ethical guidelines into law? Because ethics is one thing, but I'm not an engineer, nor an ethicist or philosopher. I'm a legal scholar. How the law is the thing that actually counts. You need compliance with the law. So how do you translate these ethical requirements into the law? And especially, are they already translated in the law? We did this exercise with the Knowledge Center. We examined this. But again, I think cooperation is necessary in this to really see where gaps are in the existing framework. This is the first thing. In 2020, we all know it. I assume that all of you have heard about it, that the white paper on AI was adopted by the European Commission. It was a very promising, long-awaited, and finally in February 2020, it was there together with its data strategy. The aim of this white paper was to create an ecosystem of excellence. So the EU should become an ecosystem of excellence. It should be investing in AI. The AI should be, there should be the uptake by AI by the public sector. SMEs should have access to AI. There should be a digital innovation hub in each member state. So a lot of specific actions to make sure that the European Union is ready for this AI revolution or evolution. On the other hand, and more important for the scholar, for the legal scholars amongst us, is that the EU aim to create an ecosystem of trust. We need an ecosystem of trust. In order to have trust, in order to fully deploy these AI systems, trust is necessary. How would it do this? Well, the EU adopted a risk-based approach, meaning that that high-risk AI systems would be regulated and would have to comply with additional requirements. And what is high-risk AI? What is a high-risk AI system? Well, two criteria, depending upon the sector. Its use. It could be that some sectors are more risky than others, for example, transport or health. And also within that sector, this is the second requirement, the use needs to be create some potential issues, and there should be some risks. So this combination of both criteria determine whether there is a high risk AI system. Although there are some exceptions for systems that are always considered high risk, for example, AI systems used in recruitment sector. Now, here again, one of the important factors, I will not go into detail, but an important factor is that the white paper puts a lot of emphasis and trust into the certification of AI systems. So I think, again, this was my PhD. I think that in the future, there also an additional call for and we're already involved in several projects, but still, I think it's an issue to how do you certify these AI systems? I think this is, from a regulatory perspective, a very challenging question that follows actually from the white paper, which puts the emphasis on certification of AI systems. Now, that being said, we have this general background at the white paper, the age-like activities on ethic guidelines. We now come actually to the main focus of my presentation, namely the fact that AI systems create challenges for the legal framework, many challenges for the legal framework, privacy, consumer protection, IP law. So a lot of research is going on right now. And what I focus on a lot is on the question, what happens if AI system causes damage? We know this famous example of the Tesla accident by Joshua Brown in 2017, if I'm correct, in the United States, which actually resulted in the death of Joshua Brown. Okay, and it has been shown that the Tesla was not able to distinguish the sky from a lorry against which it collided. There are also some cases where AI systems in medical surgeries have caused some damage. So the question of liability becomes really important, that contractual liability on the one hand between the parties that are involved, but also tort liability. Tort liability, it means non-contractual liability. So for example, if you incur damage because of in a situation where you don't have a contract with someone else. So these are the focus of these documents. It's no surprise that it's a reoccurring topic, liability, within all these EU initiatives. And I will not discuss them thoroughly. I put hyperlinks so you can really find all these documents online. There's been 2020, you see, is a productive year. A lot of reports dealing with liability. Main question is always, who should be held liable? October 2020, very recently, there has been a report by the European Parliament, which states that the operator of high-risk AI systems should be strictly liable. So no fault is required when an AI system causes damage, the operator will be held liable for high-risk systems, of course. Other recurring topic, and I will come to this later, is the question, do we need to provide legal personality to AI systems that you don't have to claim different parties, that you can just direct the AI system itself? It has been rejected, but I will come to it later. So a lot of documents have been adapted regarding to liability, and all of these identify some problems. Which approach do we need as EU, European Union? Where do we go? Which direction? Which are the pending issues? And if you dive into these documents, you actually see that one of the recurring topics, and I think very important within the context of this meeting, is the Product Liability Directive. I will not discuss all the problems that arise, but I will just show that there are some challenges that are created by AI systems to this Product Liability Directive that applies in the whole European Union. So what does it say? Under the Product Liability Directive, a producer of a product is liable for damage caused by a defect in this product. So the moment your product has a defect, the producer can be held liable. This is the core of this Product Liability Directive. Now, of course, when you apply this to AI systems, well, a lot of challenges arise. First one is software considered a product? There's a lot of debate on this question. If it's not a product, well, then falls outside of the scope of the directive. If it is a product, then it falls within the scope of the directive. Let me illustrate this. If you have a self-driving vehicle, of course, it relies on software. The vehicle itself falls within the Product Liability Directive because it's all movable. It's a movable, and the directive refers to a product is a movable. But for software as such, standalone software, this might be more challenging, and there's a lot of debate. Another challenge that I show with this Product Liability Directive is the notion of defect. The defect is defined as product is defective when it does not provide the safety one is entitled to expect. We refer to this as the legitimate expectations. Now, how would you apply this in the context of AI? What can an average person, a consumer, for example, expect from AI systems? The liability directive refers, for example, to the information regarding a product. A product will be defective when it does not provide the safety, thereby taking into account the way in which the product is presented. But this again creates a very difficult reasoning for AI producers, because of course self-driving vehicles, producers of autonomous vehicles tend to show, it has been the fact some years ago, emphasize the safety of self-driving vehicles. Autonomous vehicles would be safer than non-autonomous vehicles. But by emphasizing this safety aspects, they provide information and they increase the safety expectations. So the more emphasis on safety, the higher your risk as a producer of liability, because the legitimate expectations are increased. So you see, actually, there's a lot of challenges within this product liability directive, also some defenses for producers that could become very challenging in an AI era. But we can discuss this during the Q&A, but I will not go into this right now. What are some other elements? Well, some say we should consider AI as animals or employees and apply that liability regime and mostly national liability regimes to AI and robots. Another fundamental issue that is always reoccurring is the question to which extent AI systems should be given legal personality, so that we do not have to find the producer, that we not have to claim compensation from the operator or user, but we can just target the AI system. I'm not saying that I'm not taking any side of good or wrong, it's just a reoccurring topic within the discussion. And also several questions regarding to fault-based liability. So we had the general framework and the regulatory framework on AI with the white paper, the HLEC group. We saw some problems within this product liability directive, which is reoccurring and very important within the legal regulatory aspects of AI. And I will now come to some statements which could also be used for discussion afterwards, which I think will shape 2021 when it comes to AI. Of course, I hope Corona is a major concern, but I hope in 2021 we will have some clarifications on this matter. So the first one is what I call the AI tort law dilemma. We see AI listed several initiatives at the EU level, that we regulate a lot. There's a lot of potential regimes, possible regulation. But in fact, tort law in Europe, in the European Union, remains national. And this creates problems. Let me illustrate this. A lot of in these documents, the proposed regimes for the operator of a liability AI system, or even within the product liability directive, there are several concepts which require national judges to look at it. These concepts are interpreted by national case law. So, for example, reasonable, force majeure, due diligence, all these concepts are used a lot within these EU documents, but still require a national interpretation. So the national judge has to explain and interpret these concepts, to adequately monitor the product. So the question that I launch here is an EU approach regime, is an EU liability regime, is it desirable? And more importantly, is it feasible? Do we need an EU regime if most of the things still, most of the concepts, most of the interpretations, most of the application of law is still very national bound? Which level do we need this regulation? And the previous presenter talked about local and global. Well, this question also reflects into the legal framework, and I think this could be very interesting for a discussion. Instead of providing broad liability regimes at the EU level, I think the EU would do better job. I think it's my own opinion, of course, to provide clarity on fundamental issues. Why does it not provide clarity on the question whether AI is whether software is a product? A clear question. Why does it not provide clarity on the question how and when is an AI system defective? Not the definition of the applicable framework, but no, really some concrete guidelines, because judges are being confronted with questions regarding the regulation of AI. Just think of the Netherlands. So some weeks ago, a claim has been filed against Uber because of the algorithmic decision regarding the people to hire or to fire people within this robo-firing setting. So again, I call the EU to really focus on more minimal aspects that could have a maximal output. This is the first one. The second one is the foundations of tort law. To sum it up, all these documents that I listed, and I included the hyperlinks again, depart from the assumption that actually a risk of liability for either party could increase, has an influence on the behavior. For example, there's one suggestion saying we should put the liability upon the operator of the AI, upon the party that is best able to minimize the risks of an AI system. So again, you would provide liability, the trigger of liability could influence the behavior of, for example, the deployer or the developer to act more carefully, put simply. So this is what we call the deterring effect of tort law. Ex ante risk of liability creates safer behavior, less risk and less accidents, more safety. This is a very good departing point, but if you look at academic scholarship, this starting point has been contested. People do not act rationally, and this assumption of the law and economics approach departs from rational behavior. Empirical studies even show that tort law does not have this deterring effect. So if this basic assumption of tort law is not applicable to AI systems, how should we deal with it? Maybe we should look at other possibilities, go away from tort law, as AI systems may become safer and could already become safer than humans. So the question is, do we still need liability? Could we not establish insurances or, for example, funds? So this is an option. But my point is that we have to take into account that the foundations of tort law are being challenged by AI systems, and we policymakers should take this into account when developing new frameworks. And finally, my last question, statement and food for thought, I'd say, relates to the question that tort law and for damage caused by AI, so liability for damage caused by AI, has to be seen in relation to procedural law. Because a victim under national law, the basic general rule is that you as a victim have to show the damage you incurred. Okay, there may be some exceptions, but the basic rule is that you have to prove your damage, the cause and the wrongful behavior. But this is very challenging for victims of AI systems, because they do not always have access to the way in which these systems work. They do not always have access to the data that is used. So I think it is very important that we should be aware that the procedural law goes hand in hand with positive law. So if you provide a liability regime for AI systems, whether it's the operator, the producer, the deployer, or the user, you have to look at the side effect, namely what is the benefit, how victims deal with it. Do we not need to reverse the burden of proof? Should we not think about lowering the burden of proof? So I think in 2021, and it's been raised in several of these documents, that we should consider how do we protect victims, because we can talk about that AI can be safe and ethical and human-centered. But still, in the end, if you incur damage, you just need to show the several elements. You need to show that the product is effective. You need to show that the AI system or the producer or the deployer or whomever caused the damage. So I think we have to be aware of these procedural elements and consider whether we should not reverse or lower the burden of proof. So in conclusion, and I hope I'm still within my time, Europe has been actively involved in regulating AI, a lot of initiatives, white papers, ethical guidelines. So a lot has been done. But still, 2020 was a productive year. But I think that several contested issues with regard to liability. I'm quite sure that many others remain in other legal fields, but my area is, of course, liability, remain, and that these may need to be resolved in 2021 according to the lines that I mentioned here. And I hope that 2021 will bring more clarity on this regard. And I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Jan, for this very interesting and from a different perspective presentation, which is definitely the legal aspect has definitely to be taken into consideration, because as you said, there are lots of legal implications when AI systems are considered as thinking systems or decision making systems. Okay, at this point, I would like to welcome questions from the audience, if there are any. From my view, just as a triggering the discussion, I can say that I realize that AI has two faces, from what I gather from the talks. On the one hand, it gives us the satisfaction that at last, through the years, through the different civilizations, or through the human civilization, at last we have something in our hands to free us from tedious labor and move to move away the fact that we are born to work and our bread, as the Old Testament says. But on the other hand, it makes us think and dive, make a deep dive into our soul, into our different cultures, and into might become an enabler of globalization and by diving into these dark corners of our existence. So we have two things to balance. One is the inspiration and the hope that we're going to be freed from the tedious laboring that we were destined to do in order to earn our living. But on the other hand, it would help us. In order to do that, we have to dive into the deep corners and the dark corners of our existence. And I think that's a challenge for the next hundreds of centuries in front of us for the human civilization. So please, if you have anything to say or anything to ask the distinguished speakers, if you want to discuss anything, please, now is the time.
Well, thank you all. I want to also say what the rest has been saying, that we cannot see AI as something that stands on its own, will work on its own, but that it will always be kind of related with humans. And I gave examples, but George and Michail gave as many examples on that it is all about awareness. Not only we scientists or engineers should know that, but kind of everybody should know that AI will not stand on its own for forever. That is always there's always humans behind, and humans will interact with it, and humans will be involved and will make the difference in everything that has been done. Is it items or is it finding the right data?
I would also like to build on that. So I also feel that this coevolution, and this is one of the challenges that Jan pointed out. So we do not know a priori. You know, people, and it's very common that people ask, "How come you haven't solved this?" And it's related to the belief, somehow the religion of science, right? That science knows everything. So as we said before, it's a convergence process. It's very important to bring in players from different fields of operation and different backgrounds. Because essentially AI, as we all say, is a social phenomenon as well. So we need social scientists. And all these opportunities, I see them as opportunities for discussion across domains. This September, we had the Hellenic, let's say, the CERN 2020. It was the Pan-Hellenic, let's say, conference on AI, right? So, and which is actually international. And then it was we brought Vincent Mueller, who said, "Okay, guys, this is the first time I'm actually invited as an ethics person, because he works on the philosophy and ethics of AI, to a technical conference." So I think this was an amazing admission that we need collaboration. So for me, this kind of challenges that appear also in the legal setting, because we also work a lot with the legal setting, and there is an amazing set of challenges there. This is one aspect. So you need the legal people to identify the problems that systems will raise. And there is also another aspect. I'm also happy, as sci-fi, my second affiliation, let's say, to be part of the SME, Small Medium Enterprise, focus group on AI for the EU. We started with 40 companies around the Europe, and now we've reached 100. There you will see that this thought dilemma that Jan pointed out can be a real inhibitor. So we say, I do not really know whether I should start investing on AI, or there will be a huge risk there about damage they most may cause to others implicitly. So small to medium enterprises request clearer rules, and this kind of at least foundational, let's say the foundation building, where they can understand what they can do and cannot do. So I feel that opening up the discussion is one of the challenges that we have to face. And getting back to what I think Michail said, is that training the people, so having informed individuals about what AI is about and how we understand it, will allow us to converge to something that makes sense for all of us. And no, please.
did you want to say something?
No, it's fine. I just said that this effort of disseminating AI now goes significantly beyond technical boundaries. That's a side comment. And this is also why, hopefully, by the end of the year, there will be a Greek book I was happy to work on, let's say, for everyone about what AI is and what is not. So, and it's called AI myth busting, more or less. So we need this kind.
We should look forward to it. Okay. Please, Moro. You are muted. Moro, you are muted.
Yeah, sorry. Good evening to everyone. So first thing, I really think that AI can improve a lot our way of living. I have two questions that I realize that due to different things. One is that I was more in touch with the person looking at how to categorize the comments or the newspapers. As you know, one of the issues is the very large amount of comments that people put on anything, including from articles to others. The question is about your opinion on the possibility to categorize these type of comments in what's you will think is a sound way, and AI can of course help in it. That ties to my comment. My comment, I don't think that it's possible to find a black or white solution to most of the issues to which AI is tasked to, because even laws are very different from country to country because the societies have evolved a culture which is different. Famous example of the drivers that has to decide to hit whether a young woman or an old person is known because you may get different answers according to the country you are asked. So my question is, where do we stop? Where would we have to stop? And where do we have to stop? Because we need the freedom to take a decision, which is not the right way to do. But I am really interested in these kind of things. Thanks.
Michael, you want to reflect on that?
Sure. I will take the latter part of the question because I hear it all the time as a challenge for AI, etc., etc. I don't think it has ever been a challenge for a human. Why do you think it will be a challenge for AI? We tend to focus on this question. There was a faculty member at the Media Lab who milked that out quite a lot. But I don't think it's a realistic proposition. It's a corner case. And, you put rules in there that basically say, okay, you are going to choose the best possible outcome for you at that specific time, which is what a human would do also in this case. I don't think humans are able to make these choices, are being put into situations to do these choices. This is, the autonomous vehicle. What kind of values should we instill in an autonomous vehicle? And the bottom line there is that if you put simple rules that everybody follows, it's more important to make sure that nobody is cheating there than actually optimize the individual decision.
No, I agree. The problem is that there are no autonomous global rules that everyone follows. The interesting article on that specific case was that the statistics is completely different according to countries and societies. And I don't see this as a bad thing. I see this something which is in the nature of human beings. That means either you train the AI according to the specific rules of the specific country, but that is a never-ending story. So we always keep talking about unfairness or bias in AI. I think this is part of the human life. And for me, the point is how to live with it rather than to avoid major mistakes. rather than to try to delete it.
but if you allow me, again, those studies, those cultural studies are just cultural studies based on a theoretical question. Okay, what would you do if you found yourself in this kind of situation? Which I tend to believe that it is going to be completely different from what actually the person would do if they found themselves into that specific situation, because there is a lot of other external factors, and a decision like this, it's not going to happen in vacuum. When you are asking the question and you are making a cultural study, the question happens in a vacuum. Unfortunately, you know, in real life, these questions always happen in a much more, sorry about that, much more global context. So, oops. So I'm not sure if that will, I'm not sure about the value of these cultural studies when you are trying to design systems. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I think that there is a challenge, a big challenge for the social sciences. I mean, we still talk about and we perceive social sciences from coming from an old, you know, from 19th century or maybe 20th century. I think there is a big challenge. Social sciences have to redefine themselves. And they have to help in solving such problems. I really think that the future belongs to the social science. I'm a scientist myself, but I really think that if I had a child, I would really direct him to social sciences at this point, because I think it's going to be very, very challenging, very, very interesting, very, very, you know, innovative to deal with this deep dive I talked about before, into our soul, into our, you know, consciousness or unconsciousness, because these are the areas that we have to work. And in order to optimize AI and make AI, you know, to help us to the degree that we can imagine, because it's a lot of imagination there.
I also think that the being interdisciplinary and the social sciences will make a big difference also in, I cannot stress this enough, it's for the general public, it's, and also for us, research, it's all about awareness, eh? Like, let's take the example of the self-driving car. There's no way that a self-driving car will never make a mistake. You cannot train the system with a trillion photographs, but be sure there will be a trillion plus one situation where the light is different or whatever, and you will hit, or your self-driving car will hit another car or will hit a tree or whatever. That's something you know. And it's the other example with all the comments and NLP and our language is so difficult. Eh? It's even for if I talk to my wife and she says something, or she writes me or texts me something, so I, even as a human, you misunderstand stuff. Eh? So of course this AI system will definitely misunderstand you. Eh? If you write sarcasm, all these very special things, very special emotion, are very difficult. Eh? So I, again, putting it onto myself, my sarcasm is not the same as my wife's sarcasm. So I, lots of situations that we have quarrels or whatever, because we just do not understand one another, and we speak the same language. Yeah? So it's the awareness that definitely in these kind of situations and use cases, the machine will never be better than the human. Huh? How much we train it.
I have a favorite line there, that I think that AI was the best thing that happened to humanity.
Explain,
because, in what sense?
Because suddenly it puts humanity back into the frame, and it shows us that you know, the old second industrial revolution education direction where everybody has to become very specialized in something and become a cog in a machine doesn't really work anymore. In order to make those very, you know, complex decisions, you have to have a background on both sides, on both legs, and you cannot jump with one leg, science or humanities, anymore.
Jan, do you want to chip in something before we close?
No, not really. It's a very interesting discussion. I think it's right that it's a multidisciplinary approach, but I think it's gradually happening. If I look at Flanders, for example, I see some multidisciplinary teams. For example, within the Knowledge Center, we work together with a lot of experts outside, non-legal scholars, non-ethicists, different categories, also people from science. So I think it's getting there. If you look at all these documents at the EU level, they all stress the need for multidisciplinary approach, also digital skills, reskilling, de-skilling. I think this is an important aspect as well. So
the sad thing about that, and also looking into my own university, is that all these research institutes and on political level, on European level, these are all oil tankers. So if we want to change direction, it goes so fucking slow that if I want to come up with an interdisciplinary course that should run in the in the first grade on ICT and awareness of AI, and I want to teach that not only to an engineer but to also to a philosopher, and so in the whole first year of a university, it does not happen, because there always one professor says, "Well, no, this is my turf, and you cannot do that, and you have to go to this committee, and then the next committee, and the next committee," and it takes 5 years, unfortunately.
And I think, for example,
can I interrupt the very interesting question, because we have a question from the audience, and I think we have to honor it. It's from Jamal Shaheen. The first question is, the national specificity, in inverted commas, of AI is really intriguing. If we consider that legal and ethical frameworks are nationally locally bound, then do global frameworks for AI make sense? I mean, we touched that before, didn't we? And I think the conclusion is that at the moment, we cannot go to global frameworks, because there are the cultural differences that we have to respect, at least for the foreseeable future. Do we agree on that, or do you want to
say for a comment here? I fully agree. One more thing. We should never consider ethics and legal setting as a constant. So we should, let's say, put into action processes that will be able to follow the ethics of the community. This has been happening all the years, right? So that the systems can follow the systems or their use, or their let's say, of our negation to their use, because not using AI is an option, right? Everyone says we need. So we have somehow to be able to follow through, to follow the society.
And respect the cultural, although we in the West, we tend to think that Western civilization, it might be wrong, it might be right for many aspects, is somehow a progressed civilization. We have to take others, like the value of other civilizations.
I feel this, for an open-minded scientist, is one way. You always have to respect knowledge coming from others to be able to have a holistic view of things.
Yeah, and it's not only knowledge, it's culture also.
I agree. Knowledge, right, ethics.
And I want to go to the second question. Is there a hierarchy of disciplines, or will AI require different types of researchers, developers, policymakers that are trained in ethics, computer science, law, politics? Or B, do we really need new ways of doing research, integrating experts from all these disciplines into specific things? I think we could tackle that. Definitely we need
B.
A multidisciplinary. And not only I went a step further. Scientists and different experts from different expert domains, they have to reinvent themselves and redefine themselves, because we have new problems different than the 19th century and the 20th century problems that especially social scientists were facing. Okay, Yeah, one last
a very brief comment here, but think that we also come to face the same exact questions that we claim social scientists have been able to face, have not been able to face. So we, these are essentially the basic challenges humanity faces.
Brilliant. It's 1 minute past eight. Unless there is something pressing to be said, let's close the webinar. I hope that it was to everybody's satisfaction and we didn't disappoint the audience. Thank you very much to the distinguished speakers and for the talk and the time and the effort they put. And thank the Think Nexus project from the NGI program of the Commission that hosted this webinar. And I hope we keep in touch and we have the chance to take these conversations further in the future. Thank you very much all.
In real life, hopefully.
Some
conference.
In real life and stay healthy, stay healthy.
Yeah, bye. Thank you all.
Thank you,
everyone. It's been an honor.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.